Hello everyone, my name is Kent and welcome back to my workshop. I'm working on a project that uses a ball screw with two support blocks. The fixed side support block has a retaining nut that preloads the bearings. Insufficient torque on the retaining nut will allow backlash, while excessive torque will create binding. The nut is square and I didn't have a socket suitable for use with a torque wrench. Today we'll model a custom socket in Fusion 360, machine the socket on a manual lathe and CNC mill, and finally, we'll put the new tool to good use.
This is the part that we're going to create. We'll start with 1-inch hex stock material. We'll rough cut it, face it on the lathe, drill and bore a 5/8-inch hole through the center. After the lathe work, we'll transfer to the CNC mill and we'll finish the operations there. The operations are in two setups consisting of 3D adaptive clearing and 2D contouring. The first setup is to cut the portion that will receive the retaining nut, while the second setup is to reduce the hex so it will fit a 3/4-inch socket. A 3/8 4-flute end mill lowers down the hole previously made on a lathe and clears a receiving hole for the retaining nut. The outside material is also cleared to create clearance with the support block. 2D contouring is used as a finishing operation. Two passes are made to compensate for tool spring back. Using wrist machining, a 1/8-inch end mill adaptively clears material inaccessible to the 3/8-inch end mill, especially in the corners. This works well except at the bottom, where the different radiuses of the two end mills results in a more complicated tool pass. Finally, a 2D contour operation is used to finish the sides. The second setup is simply to reduce the hex to 3/4-inch. A 3/8-inch end mill is used to adaptively clear most of the material. We'll now export the tool paths to Linux CNC, and the CNC machine will make the custom tool for us, almost entirely by itself, and that's really amazing. The stock we're using is 1-inch hex 1215 steel. McMaster calls 1215 very easy to machine steel, and it certainly is easier to machine than 1045 that I previously used on the drawbar. On the lathe, we'll face both sides and bore a hole through the center. While both operations could be performed on the mill, for hex stock it's probably more convenient to use the lathe. After spot drilling, we drill a 1/2-inch through hole. The through hole allows the ball screw to pass through the socket. The diameter of the through hole is not critical, and we could have drilled directly the 5/8-inch. However, other than internal threading, boring is my favorite operation on the lathe, and I could use the practice. At the mill, we'll use the axis of the through hole and the top of the part as our origin. First, an axis is zeroed roughly at the furthest point on the circle. This is done on the opposite side to measure the distance across the circle at this point. This may be less than the diameter. That's okay. Retract along the axis to half this value. In the presence of backlash, consider making approaches from only one direction. When you're to the target value, zero the axis and repeat for the perpendicular axis. The origin is now along the axis of the through hole. The milling operations use 3/8-inch and 1/8-inch end mills. Both end mills are 4-flute and from Lakeshore Carbide. The end mill drops down the through hole, allowing it to immediately start cutting at full depth. The first operation is a 3D adaptive clearing to create a receiving pocket for the retaining nut. I was impressed with how well the 1215 steel cut, and in many ways I prefer cutting it to aluminum. This is a continuation of the 3D adaptive clearing operation that created the receiving pocket. Here, extra material is being removed to create clearance for the socket into the ball screw support block. Not shown are a couple passes of the same tool following a 2D contour tool path to perform a finishing operation. Using rest machining and a 1/8-inch end mill, material inaccessible to the 3/8-inch end mill is now removed. This is done at two depths. At the first depth, the material removal is pretty efficient. The tool path becomes strange and slow at the bottom. A lot of the seemingly unnecessary cutting is because the two tools have different radii. The 3/8 inch end mill has a 20 thou corner radius, while the 1/8 inch end mill has a 10 thou corner radius. There may be a rest machining option to ignore that small difference in radii and focus instead on the major removal in the corners. The chips from the 1/8 inch end mill are super fine and unfortunately penetrate skin pretty easily. While tedious, I do enjoy finishing a part using sandpaper on a surface plate. The sandpaper is adhered to the surface plate with a light spray of 3M adhesive. A figure eight pattern is used to avoid directional biases. Polishing is performed with a felt wheel, Dremel, and polishing compound. The retaining nut slips into our new tool, and our new tool in turn slips into a 1-inch socket. Perhaps the tool is more appropriately called a socket adapter instead of a socket. We could stop here, but due to a lack of planning, I can't use the 1-inch socket. The 1-inch socket uses 1/2-inch drive, and my torque wrench is 3/8-inch drive. Instead of getting a drive adapter, I'm going to recut the hex to 3/4-inch. While it seems a shame to mar the polished surface, in the end we'll have a more convenient tool. Touch off is identical to before, aligning with the axis of the through hole. An adaptive clearing operation is again used, followed by a contouring operation for finishing. There's room for improvement with chip evacuation. The larger chips clear the surface nicely, but fine chips tend to stick to coolant-covered surfaces. An unexpected benefit of reducing the hex is that there is now a shoulder for the socket, and that makes this tool more convenient. Being able to quickly make changes like this is a wonderful reason to have machines for prototyping. Here is the retaining nut. It has a small brass insert that presses into the threads of the ball screw, securing the retaining nut in place. Our new tool now slips over the retaining nut, and the ball screw is held in place with a wrench on machine deflats. This is a 10mm ball screw, and our torque wrench is set to 9.3 Nm. And that's it. The retaining nut on the ball screw is now properly torqued. This is a nice example of a small CNC machine for prototyping. There is a need for a tool to complete a project that may not exist. A design and part were made and then iterated upon in a few hours. I find this very rewarding, and you have to wonder what may be possible if the younger generation could have similar experiences at an early age. Self-reliance, creativity, both could be boosted, and what else? As always, thank you for taking the time to watch, and I would love to hear from you.